Good evening, everybody. It is an evening here. It's a beautiful, dark evening in Amsterdam. Clear, no wind. There was a bit of a hurricane last night, so I'm glad that's moved away. Welcome to everybody to this second in the Live from Amsterdam series, although we are actually in the Lutherse Kerk in Haarlem today. It's a church that Alex and I got to know in January. We came and did a recording here. It's a very beautiful church, so I'm very glad to share the space with you. We would have been sharing an audience with you, like the last concert that we did from the Walserkerk in Amsterdam, but restrictions have intervened in that, so we thought it was safer just to do it with the two of us and the crew here, so there won't be any audience here, but I'm very glad that you could join us. And a big thank you, as always, to David Lowe and the board of Philharmonia Baroque, and also all of the subscribers and the donors who have been following us with this series so far. This is entitled sort of Bach in the Coffee House, Double Espresso. We'll come to that a little bit later. We've got a nice few cups of different kinds of coffee for you. We start with a sort of Spanish coffee, music by Padre Antonio Soler. And I'm just going to step back and show you this. This is what we are going to play. Isn't it messy? It's very, very messy, but it's close to the composer. This is a manuscript which survives in El Escorial, just outside Madrid, where Soler ended up working at the end of his life, in the last decades of his life. And they're written for, as it says in the manuscript, two organs. Now, like cembalo in Germany, that just sort of means keyboards, and as we have two harpsichords here, we'll be playing them on harpsichords, although they will work very happily, and often in churches, in Escorial, there are two antiphonal organs, so you could have organ battles. And that's important, that you hear the word organ and you think it's very holy and it should be very serious and churchy. Not at all. These were written for diversion and fun. So this is the third of these concertos for two keyboard instruments by Soler, in G major. It's in two movements. The first movement is a sort of genial andantino with lots of exchanges, then a minuet with six variations, which gets a little sillier as it goes along, but they are great, great fun. So here we start with Soler. Thank you. So from the slightly ridiculous to the very sublime, we now approach François Couperin, one of the greatest composers for harpsichord of all time, along with his uncle Louis. We're going to play four pieces of François Couperin, only one of which is actually written out for two harpsichords. We know that he sanctioned the use of two harpsichords for performing his chamber music, Les Nations, and also some of the Concert Royal. He gives instructions as to how you can do that. So we took that as a starting point and put together a suite of four movements in A. But first of all, just to talk a little bit about the instruments we have here today. One is quite old and one is very new. This instrument that Alexandra is playing was made pretty much exactly 29 years ago. I took it on tour for the first time 29 years ago. It's a copy by Joel Katzman of a Rooker's instrument from 1638, a revival with two keyboards. It's a wonderful instrument. I've spent many years with it, obviously, and we thought we'd sort of do a his and hers swap on this. This is Alexandra's instrument, which was made this year. It's still not officially out of the gate yet, but we've been using it because it's so wonderful, made by Tom Power. This is after Couchet from 1679. So they're sort of a family connection between the two makers. Beautiful instruments and perfect for this kind of repertoire. Back to Couperin. So we've chosen four pieces in A. I'll play a little prelude, which Couperin put one of the preludes that he wrote down in L'Art de Toucher. This is the fifth prelude, beautiful prelude in A major, which is a beautiful key of love, often with Mozart particularly, but here also, as you'll hear when we get to the fourth piece. We'll then follow it with two pieces from the third Concert Royal, a Musette and a Chaconne. And during this, these two pieces, we'll be sort of splitting the written parts between the two of us and playing against each other, contrepartie, improvising continuo around what's going on for those two pieces. And the fourth piece is from the ninth Ode, an Allemande specifically for two harpsichords, and I think it has to be one of his most gorgeous and delicious twiddly pieces for two instruments. It's absolutely divine, so I hope you'll enjoy it.
Thank you. Thank you.
we move to Germany, a composer, Johann Caspar Kerl, who you may not have come across. He wrote a lot of music which is lost. He wrote 11 operas and all sorts of music which unfortunately is lost, but what we do have is of incredibly high quality. We know that Bach knew his music very well. He even arranged some music as his own in the Sanctus in D major from Kerl. So Kerl was around in the 17th century, born 1620s and died towards the end of the century. Wrote some fantastic keyboard music, amongst which there are a couple of long forms. There are very few forms in the Baroque period which are sort of open-ended and that you could jam on. Something that if you had a number of continuations like harpsichords or lutes together, you could just jam on standards like what jazz people would know. And those were the Pascal and the Chaconne. And Kerl wrote examples of both. The surviving piece is just for one keyboard, but it's much more fun with two. I've even done it with four, and that's even more fun. But what we've done, we've taken the piece and we'll sort of improvise a little bit, and then the piece will start at some point, and we'll sort of divide up the solos, if you like, and accompany each other sometimes as we go. And it can make quite a racket, I'll tell you. now finally to J.S. Bach and the Coffee House. It'd be nice to think that perhaps he and one of his sons or one of his students played some of that music you just heard, probably not the Soler, because that just was hidden in El Escorial. But he certainly would have known the carol, and he would have known the couplin for sure. And maybe when they were in Zimmermann's Coffee House, which was a great gathering place, there was a collegium musicum there, which Bach took charge of in 1729, and Zimmermann's Coffee House was one of the latest crazes in Europe was coffee, and coffee houses became incredible places to meet and listen to music, and there were two-hour concerts given by Bach and the Collegium Musicum in the ground floor rooms, big ground floor rooms at this coffee house. And certainly this piece that you're about to hear, the concerto in C major for two harpsichords, would have been played there. They had multiple instruments there, harpsichords as well as horns and all sorts of stuff. And these pieces are really quite extraordinary, the multiple concertos by Bach. Bach took as his model Vivaldi, who wrote concertos for multiple string instruments, lots of violins or many violins and cellos. So he took that idea and transformed it and transferred it to the harpsichords, which again was a brilliant leap of faith on his part. He'd already taken that leap of faith a little bit with the concerto for harpsichord itself, with the Brandenburg Five, which is the first time in music history that the harpsichord is a concerto instrument within a group. But these multiple harpsichord concertos are quite extraordinary creations. There are three doubles. This C major double survives in a version without the strings, and when the strings were added, they do very little. In fact, they're not in the slow movement at all. And they just sort of play around in the tutties, in the outer movement. But this version for two harpsichords without any strings is from Bach himself. Wonderful piece, a really fun C major. Lots of joy and simplicity and purity and fun. The three movements, the first movement hasn't the tempo marking, just an opening allegro. A gorgeous, gorgeous largo. It's a very serious slow movement, but beautiful. Very Russian, actually. It's in A minor, so it must be Russian. And then a fabulously fun fugue to finish with. One of the sources marked vivace, which means vivacious, it doesn't necessarily mean fast. It starts off, it's a quirky subject, and it takes a time to get warmed up, and we trade off material. But by the time we get to the end of it, we've certainly had our double espressos, and that will finish the concert. Thank you. Thank you for joining us this evening, this morning, wherever you are. It's a great pleasure playing for you. I hope you are safe and well and stay that way. And we will see you again. Look out for the third episode of What's New and Hip with Tarek and Rick, special guest star. Just check it out. And there's another Live in Amsterdam coming at the beginning of November as well. So thank you for joining us for this marvellous amount of harpsichord. It's great fun to play. So thank you, Alex. And have a great time. And please stay safe and well. Goodbye.